Yes. So I would like to thank the organizers for this opportunity to talk on this conference. And title of my talk is Decomposition. Conjecture for G-series. So roughly speaking, we will be interested in computation of G-theory of group ring for finite groups. And of course, it's a difficult question in general, but this conjecture allows us to decompose G-theory of a group ring in smaller pieces of nicer rings that are easier to understand. So plan for the talk is, so first I will state the conjecture and tell some history about it. So second one, we are going to test this conjecture in dimension one. So unfortunately, we will see that the general statement of conjecture is false. And there are some counterexamples even for even nice class of groups. And we will discuss what is the reason for these counterexamples. And this will be explained in terms of modular representations. And we will say what can be done to fix this conjecture. So first, let us recall what is G-theory. If we are given some Noetherian ring, R, then we can consider category of all finitely generated modules over R. And this is a nice category, abelian category, so we can apply Quillen's construction. And define G-theory of a ring, of Noetherian ring, just as K-theory of this category of all finitely generated modules over R. So end remark. If ring is nice enough, for example, regular, and as examples of regular rings, you can think about fields or Dedekind domains. Then we have a natural map from usual K-theory to G-theory, and it is an isomorphism. So of course we always have this map that is called Cartan map. And in this case, it is an iso. So the story of this conjecture started in 81 by theorem of Lenstra, who showed that if R is Noetherian and G abelian finite group, then G-theory of group ring RG decomposes into a direct sum, where sum runs over let's say CG. So CG is set of cyclic quotient of G. So quotients are considered to be different if they are coming from different subgroups. So even if factors are abstractly isomorphic, but they are coming from different subgroups, then we consider them to be different. So sum is running over cyclic subgroups, and G theory of R tensor Z adjoint primitive C is root of unity, but this is order of the cyclic subgroup, and we also want to invert C order of this. So this group, this ring is Dedekind domain. So if we just forget about R, and let's say R equals to Z, then we don't have this. And then G theory is just K theory. And this is known to be class group, ideal class group of this ring. So in case of abelian group, our G theory of a group ring decomposes into quite simple pieces. So of course, I'm not claiming that ideal class group is something easy to understand, but at least we can do K theory instead of G theory, which is a bit easier. So then, like motivation for this theorem was something that is called SSF groups. And these are some groups that contain, so they house some invariants that are obstructions for Morse-Smale diffeomorphisms. So we are not going to discuss this, but just as a motivation, there was some question coming from dynamical systems. Then, of course, it is a natural question to ask whether this decomposition holds for higher G groups, and. Yeah, it's just name of people. Yes, exactly. Yes, it's just first letters of surnames of people who were doing this. So we are not going to discuss these groups, just a remark. So later, Webb proved exactly the same decomposition for all n's, for gn. So same. For all Gn and abelian group again. And then, so people proved some similar decomposition for some other groups that were not abelian anymore, and they decided to guess a general answer for all groups. And So they came up with this conjecture that is due to Hambleton, Taylor, and Williams. So now conjecture is for all dimensions and all groups. So for any finite group G, they wanted to have that G theory of group ring. So the conjecture was stated with coefficients in any Noetherian ring, but let's just restrict ourselves to that. So now it's direct sum running over set of all irreducible rational representations of G. So this is set of all irreducible rational representations of G. So here I really mean representations over Q of G theory of some rings that I now call lambda rho. And now I have to explain what are these rings. So lambda rho is maximal order in some division algebra. So here we have two unknown signs on the blackboard. So this number and division algebra. So now I will explain this statement. So first let's start, what is G rho? So one way to describe it is we can consider QG. This is now semi-simple algebra. So it is a product of simple algebras, which are matrix rings over division algebras. So it's a product of matrix algebras over these G rows. So this is called Wedderburn decomposition. So this is one way how to think about these G rows. Another way is, for example, if we have rational representation of G, then G rho is just endomorphisms of this space. And this is our division algebra. So to each rational representation, we associated this division algebra. And now I have to say, what is this omega rho? So this is just a number, integer number. And it is defined as follows. So we take order of G, we divide it by order of kernel of our representation, and then we take dimension of any complex irreducible constituent of rho. This means that we start with a rational reducible representation, and then we want to make it complex representation. So we tensor it over Q with C. So now it's complex representation, but it's not necessarily reducible as a complex representation. So this is a direct sum of irreducible complex representation, and they all have same dimension because they are Galois conjugate. So rho IC irreducible complex representations of G of the same dimension. So we defined our number as order of G divided by kernel divided by dimension of one of this irreducible complex constituents. And so this is integer number. Why? Because if you just consider our representation as a representation of G mod kernel of rho, it's still a representation of this group. And this is a reducible representation, and there is a general fact that a dimension of complex irreducible representation divides order of group. So this should divide order of a group G mod kernel of rho. So this is an integer. So now we have a statement of this conjecture. And as a small example, let's see that it is consistent with our theorem for abelian groups. So first, let's start with Wedderburn decomposition of QG when G is abelian. So it will be just a product of rows running over irreducible rational representations. And we know that irreducible rational representations are in bijection with conjugacy classes of cyclic subgroups. But since our group is abelian, it's just all cyclic subgroups. Or, in other words, cyclic quotients. And we don't have any matrices and no division algebra. This will be just fields. And like these are matrices of dimension one. So it will be Q adjoint C's root of unity. So this is a Wedderburn decomposition in this case. So next, what we want to do, so our division algebras in this case are these fields. Now we want to take maximal z adjoint 1 over omega rho order in this field. So we want to compute what is omega rho. So omega rho is order of G divided by kernel divided by dimension of irreducible constituent complex. But we know that all irreducible complex representations of abelian group is one-dimensional, so nothing here. And since G mod kernel is a subgroup in C, it is cyclic. So this is cyclic. G mod kernel should be cyclic as subgroup in complex numbers. And therefore, this is exactly what we want. So this is some cyclic group. So our omega rho is some C, where C cyclic. And we want to take Z adjoint 1 over C maximal order in G rho in this field. And this will be just ring of integers in here adjoint this number. And we know that ring of integers in cyclotomic field is just Z adjoint this root of unity. And then we adjoint 1 over C. And this is exactly the ring from Lenstra's theorem. So at least this conjecture is consistent with previous result for abelian groups. So later, Webb was trying to prove this for arbitrary groups, and of course they decided to test it on simplest groups that you can imagine. It's symmetric groups, permutation groups. And so they just computed by hands ranks of G1 for symmetric groups. And they found out that S5 is already a counterexample. So now we are moving to part two, which is our test in G1. So why exactly in G1? Because for some reasons, rank and torsion of G1 of group ring is easy to compute, and it was done by Keating. So now I will present the formula computation by Keating, and then it is possible to compute ranks of G1 of these maximal orders, like to obtain a very general formula that is easy to deal with. So first, I need some notation. So if we have our irreducible rational representation rho, then we know that we can associate division algebra G rho to it. And then we can take center of this division algebra, so which I denote by E rho, and this is an algebraic number field. So maybe one useful fact about this, that this is just a field of character values of rho of any complex constituent of rho. So as I wrote upstairs. So if I complexify rho, then I take any irreducible complex summand of this, and then I take a field of character values of this complex representation, then I obtain exactly this field. And then, of course, we can take ring of integers of this number field. So let's denote by V rho number of different prime ideals in O rho that divide principal ideal generated by order of a group G. So this is our first notation. So ring of integers is Dedekind domain. We have unique factorization in prime ideals. So we can take just principal ideal generated by order of a group and decompose it into product of prime ideals, and we take set of different prime ideals. So this is our V rho, and U rho is rank of group of units in O rho. Then formula of Keating for rank is So we take sum over all rational irreducible representations. We take these two numbers, v rho and u rho, and then we should subtract all modular representations. So by modular representations, I mean FP representations where P divides order of a group G. So we should subtract number of all irreducible FP representations of G. So this is formula for computation of rank. So also we can prove that rank of lambda rho is u rho plus number, again, it's the same pattern, prime ideals. Oh, sorry, yes, G1. So number of prime ideals in O rho that now should divide not an order of a group, but principal ideal generated by our number omega rho. So here we have these two very explicit formulas. And now I will call by P of G P because predicted. So predicted rank of G by predicted rank of G1 of ZG. So this is sum of ranks of G1 lambda rho. And R of G is a real rank. So of course, if our conjecture is true, these two numbers should be the same. But let's consider the difference. And we see that these numbers, they go away. And we are left with now modular representations. And plus, sum over irreducible rational representations. So we want this with plus. So I call this number W rho. So W rho minus V rho. So what we can do with this sum? So of course, we have that V rho is just number of prime ideals that divide order of a group G, and W rho is number of prime ideals that divide this number omega rho. So omega rho divides order of a group G because it's like G divided by some two other numbers. So omega rho is smaller than our G. So this we can rewrite as sum over rho in XG and then sum over prime numbers that divide order of a group G. And then what we have. So in case omega rho is not divisible by P, then we have no contribution from omega rho and only contribution from order of a group G. So we have minus number of prime ideals in O rho that divide prime P. And in case both numbers omega rho and G are divisible by P, then these two numbers will just cancel out. So we have minus number of prime ideals in O rho that divide principal ideal generated by prime number P. So in case so if omega rho is not divisible by P, otherwise it will be zero. So and in the end this formula becomes sum of modular representations minus sum over irreducible rational representations, and we count only those for which omega rho is not divisible by P. And here we have number of prime ideals in O rho dividing P. Okay, so now we have this equality for the difference of predicted rank and real rank. And so first step that I did, I just wrote a computer program computing these two numbers, and I checked for first groups of order less than 200. And I saw that, okay, we have like many counterexamples. And Webb also claimed that if for symmetric groups, it's not true, but maybe it is true for solvable groups. But also there are counterexamples for solvable groups. So one of these is matrices over F3 of size 2. So this group is a solvable counterexample. For this conjecture. But if, like, only counting this computer computation, it's not very clear philosophically what goes wrong. So now we are going to next part. We are going to understand why this can be strictly bigger than zero. So in general, this is always not less than zero. And sometimes we have strict inequality. So we go to the next part. So failure explained via modular representation theory. Oh, and here it was also sum over prime numbers dividing order of group. So let's look at this expression. Since here we have this sum over prime numbers, and since here maybe we want to put like together these pieces corresponding to different primes. So and now I claim the following inequality, that number of irreducible FP representations of G is always bigger or equal than sum over rational irreducible representations, but not all of them, only those for which omega rho is not divisible by P. And we have this strange weight of number of prime ideals in all rho that divide principal ideal generated by P. So this inequality basically is saying that we can estimate number of irreducible modular representations in term of some special rational representations counted with some weight. And weight is this decomposition of principal ideal P into prime ideals in Oro. So for this, we will need some procedure that is called reduction mod P. And this is, will explain us how to pass from complex representation to modular representation. So first of all, if we are given a finite group G, let's choose a splitting field for this group. So we don't want to work over C, we want to work over some algebraic number field. So for example, we can choose some cyclotomic extension. In particular, we can adjoin G's root of unity to Q. But it's not very important what exactly we, how we extend Q, so we just choose some splitting field for G. So next, given any representation, so ordinary complex representation, we can do a base change. So we can find some matrix such that if we conjugate by this matrix, our representation will live in ring of integers. So in this case, over this ring. So now it's already good. So we can do some number theory here, and let's choose a prime ideal in this ring of integers. That lies over P. So for this section, we fixed our prime number. So next, what we do, our modular representation will be defined over ring of integers mod out this prime ideal. So since ring of integers is Dedekind domain, prime ideal is also maximal ideal, and we have field. So this is field, and moreover, it is finite extension of FP. So we get what we wanted. We started with complex irreducible representation, and we ended up with some modular representations already, not say how. So if we had an action of G was given by matrix XG with some elements in this ring of integers, then when we do reduction mod P, we just mod out this prime ideal, and we end up in this finite field of characteristic P. So we just do this most straightforward reduction via this prime ideal. So now modular representations, they are a bit more special than usual one, because for example we don't have Mashke's theorem. So it's not true that one can write any representation as sum of irreducible representations. So in this case, also when we do reduction mod P, if so our reduction process, it involves this choice of matrix A, change of basis. And this change, like this choice of matrix A, it's not unique. And if we choose some another change of basis, we can end up in different representation, which is not equivalent to the first one. But decomposition factors are uniquely determined. So this is what we are interested in. So, warning. If you started with phi and we got phi prime, phi bar, and we were choosing some matrix A, and for example, if you were choosing some matrix A prime and we end up with phi prime bar, so it does not mean that phi bar and phi prime bar are KJ equivalent. So this is just not true. But good news, phi and phi prime have same decomposition factors. So now, like as in case of representations over field of characteristic zero, if you were speaking about some representation, we always wanted to decompose it into a sum of reducibles. And in case of modular representation, we will be just speaking about decomposition factors, because this is what is uniquely defined by representation. So warning two.
You mean the order model?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Decomposition, what would think of bringing
irreducible? No. This I mean exactly Jordan Holder decomposition. So warning two is that not every modular representation can be obtained in this way. So it's not true that we can lift any modular representation to representation over C. So not every modular representation can be lifted but here we also have and one more warning. So if we started with irreducible representations, irreducible representation over C, it doesn't mean that we will end up with irreducible representation. So reduction of irreducible representation is not necessarily irreducible. Okay. So now let's again look at what we have. We wanted to estimate FP representations in terms of some kind of special rational representations. And for this, let's make a definition. So we call a complex representation special, P special, if the corresponding number omega phi, that is now order of group divided by kernel of phi divided by dimension of phi, is not divisible by P. So this is my notation for not divisible. And note that before, like we were considering rational representations, and here I consider a complex representation. And of course, if we have that for a rational representation corresponding number omega rho is not divisible by P, it exactly means that complex constituents of rho are special representations, P special in this sense of definition. Just because kernel of complex constituent and kernel of rational representation, they are the same. So, the main tool in proving this theorem will be the following classical theorem from modular representations due to Brouwer and Nesbitt. So it says that if we have a finite group and its order is divisible by some power fp, and we have phi complex irreducible representation such that dimension of phi is divisible by this power of p. So as we remember, it is the highest possible power of p that dimension can be divisible by, because dimension of phi should divide the order of g. So in case dimension is divisible by this highest power of p, then after reduction mod p, this representation remains irreducible. So by this, I mean reduction mod p So then phi bar is irreducible. So it means that we found some class of representations that remain irreducible after reduction mod p. No. What do you mean? A, so dimension of phi should be divisible by p to the a.
First of all, does that mean maximum division?
Yes. No. It can't be higher, just because what I said. Dimension of irreducible representation always divide order of g.
So if you take any irreducible representation, phi bar is irreducible. But where's the extra hypothesis?
No, phi bar is reduction mod p of phi. So again, I started with some complex representation, irreducible complex representation, which dimension is divisible by very high power of p. No, it's divisible by p to the a. It's the highest possible power of p. No, okay. So order of... Yeah, now it's clear? Okay, sorry. So this theorem is exactly saying that if dimension of irreducible complex representation is divisible by the highest possible power of p, then it remains irreducible when after the reduction mod p. So now let's look at following picture. So here by dots, I just mean irreducible complex representation. So this is set of irreducible. So I don't want complex, I want to work over splitting field. So irreducible representations of G. Then, so this I call K. Then I have set of irreducible k bar representations of G, where k bar was finite extension of FP. Then inside set of irreducible complex representations, I have a subset of p special representations. So it doesn't necessarily mean that these are all, but this is some subset. So here we have reduction mod p process. And we know that if you take p special representation, then it remains irreducible after reduction mod p. But potentially it can happen that we have two different irreducible complex representation that reduces to the same representation. But I claim that this is not true. So I don't have time to prove it, but so proposition that reduction mod P is injective on set of P special representations. So it really means that if you restrict ourselves to P-special representation, we, in the end, we hit some subset of irreducible K-bar representations downstairs. But it also doesn't mean that we hit all FP representations. But at least at this point, it is one-to-one correspondence. So, okay. This is our picture for K and K bar representations, but we really want representations over Q and representations over FP. So it means that we want to do one more step. And we have here action of Galois group of K over Q. And here we have action of Galois group of K bar over FP. And to get irreducible representations over Q, we just have to take orbits of this section. So this is a general theorem of structure of how to get from field extension to smaller field. So let's say this is our orbit. So this is how we get our P-special Q representations. Irreducible Q representations. So these are just orbits. The same downstairs to get FP representations. We have just to take orbits of Galois action of this Galois group on this set. But it doesn't mean that these are the same orbits. But there is, so it is known that this Galois group is smaller than this. So namely, there is a subgroup of this Galois group of K over Q that surjects to this Galois group. And it means, it also follows from some statements in the theory that Galois group acts on this orbit. So if this is orbit of some element phi, then we reduce it mod P and we get this, and we have that Galois group acts on this reduction of the orbit. So we have that from one orbit here, we get several orbits here. So it means that we started from one rational representations, we got few FP representations. And number of these several FP representations is at least number of prime ideals in O row dividing P times order of some inertia group. So I'm not going to explain which group exactly, but this is what exactly what we wanted. So in our inequality, we wanted that, we don't have it here anymore, I'm sorry. We wanted that number of FP, reducible FP representations is at least sum over special representations with some weight. So we got this, that this weight is even a little bit bigger because here we have this multiple of some inertia group. And yeah, that's it. And what exactly can go wrong? Like, why sometimes we can have strict inequality? So we have two places that can produce us strict inequality. So first of all, not all of FP irreducible representations are coming from special representations. So this is first place where strict inequality can occur. And second place, this weight contains sometimes this multiple that is bigger than one. So inertia group is sometimes non-trivial. So we can get non-trivial inequality from this part. So, and in case of SL2 F3, strict inequality was occurring for p equals to 3, and exactly in this place that not all irreducible FP representations were coming from p special ones. So I'm sorry, my time is over. So maybe I say just a few words what can be done. So first of all, maybe these numbers omega rho can be made a little bit smaller than at least on the level of this test on G1, it potentially can be that we can fix the conjecture. And in case of solvable groups, at least the following statement is true, that all representations in characteristic P, they can be lifted to complex representations. So in general, this statement is not true. There are some representations, modular representations, that just can't be lifted at all. But for solvable groups, all the representations can be lifted, but not to P special ones. So maybe if we correct these numbers omega rho's, it's possible for at least solvable groups to correct the conjecture. But another way to fix it is just to say, okay, we have the inequalities, and maybe it's just injection in one direction. So it's not an either, but just an injection. Thank you.
More quick questions?
Yes.
So when you look at these kind of groups, the prime 2 is always bad. And if you look at groups of order less than 200, which are solvable, there's only like a dozen groups like that.
Right. Yeah, so interesting thing that, no, prime
so
3.
Order.
Yes, yes. Yeah, no, no counterexample for solvable groups of odd order. Yes.
Okay.
Yes, right.
More questions? Okay, then we thank you again and start again at sharp. So there's a very short break now on copies only.